Good evening. Welcome to our third session of Biotech 201, focusing on cancer. Thank you for being here tonight. I know this is an off night. This is not our normal Tuesday night. This is our makeup night, so it's great to see a whole room full of people. We have a lot of ground to cover and some really interesting stories to tell. So I'm going to jump right in. You'll ultimately find out why there's a hat rack full of unique hats next to me. It's a part of an analogy, and we'll see if it works. So we've been talking through hallmarks of cancer, and these 10 key commonalities for most forms of cancer that ultimately work together to move a cell from normal into cancerous. And we have our Jenga tower of our specific 10 hallmarks that we've worked our way through. We've gone through 5 of them so far, so we're going to cover 3 of them tonight, and we'll leave the last 2 for our final session on Tuesday. So here are the 3 we're going to talk about tonight. Avoiding immune destruction, we'll actually save that one for last. We're going to talk about the role of inflammation as a driver of cancer, and we're going to talk about reprogramming energy metabolism and dig into how cells use or make energy in order for them to advance cell division more rapidly. So let's start with tumor-promoting inflammation. So inflammation is a characteristic of many tumors, and it actually helps precancerous cells become cancerous. So it really, you'll see a quote in just a little bit, that inflammation is really the fuel that drives cancer development. And there are a whole set of things that are known to be associated with cancer. You can see them up here: chronic infection, obesity, smoking, alcohol consumption, environmental pollutants, high-fat diet. Every single one of these is a known risk factor for cancer. Intriguingly, every single one of these is also a driver of inflammation and is likely one of, if not the link, between these factors and the formation of cancer. So let's dive into inflammation a little bit more. It's how tissues and cells respond to injury. So if you've ever had a broken bone or you've had a cut or a sprain, you know the signs of inflammation: swelling, heat, redness, tenderness. That is the body's response to an injury. It's part of the healing process. So when that injury occurs, whether it's a cut or a break or a sprain or a strain, the signals recognize that there's damage, recognize that there's an open wound or that there's something that's gone wrong. And these signals recruit immune cells into the site of the damage. And these immune cells produce inflammatory chemicals that are part of the normal inflammation process. So specific immune cells come in, they secrete chemicals, those chemicals recruit blood vessels to come in, and maybe if blood vessels have been broken or damaged, they repair the blood vessels, they recruit factors that stimulate the cells to grow and reproduce, to replace the cells that have been lost. And then once you've got healing, then that inflammatory signal gets shut off. At least that's the way it's supposed to work in acute inflammation, inflammation in response to an injury of some sort. What we're talking about is chronic inflammation. And in chronic inflammation, the signals get started, the immune cells are recruited, they're producing these molecules that are recruiting blood vessels and leading to cell growth, and the signal doesn't stop. So it is an ongoing pattern of problem, of healing, of injury. And that ongoing set of inflammatory signals actually causes chaos in the body. And as you'll see in just a little bit, it actually lays the groundwork that either initiates, in some cases, cancer development, or if you've already got a set of mutations in some of these hallmark genes, actually speeds that process along. This is one of my favorite quotes from cancer researcher Fran Bockwell. If genetic damage is the match that lights the fire, so if DNA damage is what initiates this, these acquired mutations, inflammation may provide the fuel that feeds the flames. Inflammation is a main driver, something that we've known for several decades, but only recently have we really appreciated the path that connects inflammation potentially to cancer. So here are some things that commonly cause inflammation. infections that don't go away, so chronic, long-term infections. Irritants that you can't clear, so asbestos fibers or coal particles in the lungs that the body can't get rid of but continually provide irritants. An overactive immune system reaction, you have an illness or an injury and your immune system responds incredibly strongly and is unable to dampen that response. Obesity, smoking, stress, and lack of exercise. We'll dig into obesity a little bit later in more detail as well. And sometimes cancer is called the wound that doesn't heal. So if you think about it, on the screen behind me, there are some common characteristics of wounds. They involve the growth and migration and survival of new cells. They require the growth of new blood vessels. The immune cells in and around a wound secrete growth factors into the surrounding tissues to entice cells to grow to replace the cells lost by the wound. All those things are exactly what happens in cancer. So the inflammation response that normally does our cells such good as part of the healing, if carried out too long, actually is a driver, a major driver, of cell proliferation in cancer. So on the image, that is a really spotty image. The image on the right on your handout, which I recognize is also small, actually takes you from the damage at the top of the cell and the signals that say, hey, cells have been damaged, and then all these immune cells come in, they begin to secrete molecules. The formal term for this is bioactive molecules. So that's our word for the day, bioactive molecules. As part of the inflammation response, the cells secrete these molecules. And these molecules, I want to read this. I try not to read tons and tons of words to you, but I want you to read this. And as I read through this, you should be thinking about what's on our Jenga tower over here. These bioactive molecules provide cytokines, which are involved in cell-cell communication. So how one cell talks to another. Growth factors. That would be our sustained proliferative signaling. Chemokines for sustained proliferation, same piece. Cell survival signals to avoid apoptosis. That would be resisting cell death that we talked about in our last session. Blood vessel recruitment, that would be inducing angiogenesis that we talked about in the first session. Extracellular matrix modifying enzymes. Okay, that's a mouthful. The extracellular matrix is the set of collagen and fibrous tissue that your cells are surrounded by. So it's not the cells themselves, it's the extracellular matrix that provides strength and structure. And these enzymes actually remodel that extracellular matrix. And if you think about it, if I've got damage, if I've got a cut, I need to loosen that matrix so that these other molecules can get in. I need to restructure and rearrange it so that I can allow for a scaffolding for the new cells to grow. These enzymes do a number of things. They increase genome instability. That's a hallmark we'll talk about next week. They reprogram energy metabolism. That's a hallmark we'll talk about in just a second. They assist in the evasion of the immune system. So how the cancer cells slip past the immune system. We'll also talk about that hallmark tonight. And they help with the process of metastasis, which is a hallmark we'll cover next week. So I think except for replicative immortality, that pretty much covers every hallmark. The process of inflammation drives every single one of our Jenga pieces. And if you have chronic inflammation, you are hitting every single one of these pathways. And if you've got a set of cells that already have started acquiring mutations and inflammation is occurring around them, you are providing them everything they need to move towards a cancer-like state. One of the genes involved in that process, I'm not going to belabor this, Mark. So Mark's question is, if you take anti-inflammatory drugs, what happens? I'm going to hold you for, I think, maybe two slides, and I'm going to answer that question. Because that's a question that, after having what I've just said, I think many of us are thinking about, should I be taking, I'm going to now go take some anti-inflammatory drugs. So here's an example in cancer, one of the genes, NF-kappa-B. This is sometimes called the first violin of inflammatory responses. So if you know your symphony, first violin often is the lead. Everyone follows behind, sometimes first violin. NF-kappa-B is one of the early molecules activated in the process of inflammation. And on the screen behind me, and I don't want you to worry about the specific words, but each one of these pink-red boxes is a different hallmark of cancer and a set of genes in that hallmark that are activated specifically by NF-kappa-B. It is like the master regulator of the inflammatory process. Here are some examples of known inflammatory agents and the increased cancer risk that they've been associated with. So environmental risks, and I'm sorry, this is not in your handouts, I apologize. I just found this table this morning and wanted to put it up here, so it is, it's not in your written material. So environmental factors like tobacco, associated with mouth and lung cancer, and asbestos with a specific type of mesothelioma in the lungs, alcohol associated with liver. All of these are also known drivers of inflammation. Infectious agents, a lot of inflammation is caused by chronic infections, infections that are very difficult to cure. A number of cancers are associated with viral infections. We'll talk a little bit more about that in a little bit later tonight, but part of why these viruses are associated with cancer is because of this long-term inflammation that sets up this environment that is so conducive to cell growth and proliferation. And then metabolic conditions like gastroesophageal reflux, that long-term reflux sets up a chronic inflammation in and around the esophagus and is a major risk factor for esophageal cancer. And then obesity has been associated with breast, liver, prostate, colon, and esophageal cancer. In fact, it's been estimated that 15 to 30% of the cancer deaths in the United States are attributed to excess weight through this inflammation pathway. So it isn't fully understood how inflammation from how obesity, inflammation, and cancer are linked. But it's thought that cells that are adipocytes, fat storage cells that are stressed as they're storing extra fat, part of the stress response is actually signaling inflammation. And in tissues that often carry that extra fat, you set up a chronic inflammation process. So if these are cells that are already experiencing damage from other factors, maybe like in the colon, those cells are dividing rapidly and they're exposed to other environmental insults. If you've also got an area of inflammation, you've now essentially, as the earlier quote said, provided fuel for the fire. So there's a very clear link between obesity, inflammation, and specific, not every form of cancer, specific forms of cancer.
Could inflammation also be a cause of mutation? Because you have an oxidative cascade.
Could inflammation be a cause of mutation? Yes, because you are part of the inflammatory response actually generates free radicals, and those free radicals actually damage DNA. So yes, so there is that link there as well. So this comes back to the question that Mark asked, can anti-inflammatory drugs be part of cancer treatment and or prevention? And the answer is yes, with a few important caveats. So there are a number of studies that have been published that have shown that anti-inflammatory drugs, even the simple straightforward aspirin, that individuals that are undergoing cancer treatment, that anti-inflammatory drugs actually increase the benefit of the other cancer medications that they're taking. So there is a lot of data that suggests that certain dosages of aspirin actually make chemotherapy and radiation even more effective. And one school of thought is that they actually damp down the inflammation in and around that area. There's also a lot of research that's been done looking at individuals that have had cancer and then go on long-term anti-inflammatory therapy. So maybe that's aspirin, maybe that's COX inhibitors, you know that as Celebrex, for example. That's an anti-inflammatory. And there's some pretty good data that suggests that individuals that have already had a cancer but go on anti-inflammatories dramatically decrease their risk of developing another cancer. individuals with colon cancer, that's where the data seems to be strongest, decrease their risk of recurrence if they're on long-term anti-inflammatory therapy. Now, here's the challenge associated with that. Long-term aspirin, that's a systemic drug. That has impacts across all parts of your body, especially your gastrointestinal tract. And long-term aspirin therapy can cause a whole host of other problems. If any of you have ever been on a COX-2 inhibitor, specifically Celebrex, you know that one of the challenges with that anti-inflammatory is it has potential toxicity to cardiac muscles, cardiac cell. So you're trading one set of challenges potentially for another. The data across the board for non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, NSAIDs, seems to suggest that it does benefit in risk reduction during therapy, prevention of recurrence, and maybe even prevention in the first place. But there's a lot of research right now trying to find new anti-inflammatories that don't have the harmful side effects that our current crop does. So I am not telling you that you need to walk out of here and drive to your local drugstore and buy aspirin and start taking it. Do not say, Dr. Lamb said that I need to be taking aspirin therapy. I'm telling you, there's some really powerful studies, but there are also some really important caveats. But I think it does show the importance of when we damp down that inflammation, when we take some of the fuel off the fire, it makes a pretty major difference. So my best advice for you is try to avoid things that you know are common inflammatory agents. If there are things that you are routinely engaging in, environmental lifestyle choices that you know are inflammatory, try to figure out how to cut back on that. Don't just start taking anti-inflammatories and keep doing those lifestyle changes. I mean, keep doing that other lifestyle, that inflammatory lifestyle, but reduce the amount of inflammation that you've got across your body to begin with. All right, that was our first hallmark. Let's move to our second hallmark. Reprogramming energy metabolism. Okay, I'm just gonna be honest with you. This one is gonna potentially flash you back to ninth grade biology or maybe college biology. If you need to just mentally go to your happy place, I'll signal you when you can tune back in, okay? So this is all about how cells metabolize their nutrients, the food that we eat, how cells take that, break it down into small molecules, and then break it down even further and turn it into the energy that they need to carry out everyday processes. That's the process of metabolism. Cancer cells have found a way to shift the way they get their energy that lets them get more energy faster so that they can rapidly divide, rapidly copy their DNA, and rapidly make all the pieces that they need for all these new cells that are being produced. So, we're going to start with a process called cellular respiration, which is at the bottom of your slide. This is the process that takes glucose, which is the primary food source that your cells need, and turns it into a molecule called pyruvate, and then takes that molecule into your mitochondria and turns it into carbon dioxide, and along the way produces the energy that your cells need. So the currency that your cells use for energy is ATP. And this process, cellular respiration, happens in the vast majority of cells under normal conditions, requires oxygen. Cellular respiration produces somewhere from 32 to 36 molecules. Someone in here is a student that has just studied this that says, no, my textbook says 38 molecules of ATP, not 32 to 36. And yes, under the ultimate, most efficient process, it would be 38, but our cells are not fully efficient, and depending on how we move these things back and forth, it really is somewhere more like 32 to 36. But if you have a test question, 38 would be your answer. Again, not Dr. Lamb says it's 32 to 36, but okay, now this is the part that's gonna flash you back, because this is the pathway of what glycolysis and oxidative phosphorylation and cellular respiration looks like. You don't have this in your handout because I was afraid it would cause real grief for you. I just wanted you to see it. We're not gonna spend any time on it at all, except that on the left-hand side, we start with glucose up here at the top in blue, and you follow these green arrows all the way down to pyruvate. and then you take it into the mitochondria, which is this structure on the right, and it goes through this Krebs cycle, and then you pump electrons. Anyway, you get a lot of energy, 32 to 36 pieces or currencies of ATP. That's the normal process. Happening all the time. The cookie that you ate when you came in and sat down, your cells are working it through right now. Right now. You are making ATP. All right, here's the alternate pathway in yellow. Aerobic glycolysis. This occurs generally in the absence of oxygen. So if you are exercising, if you are being chased by a bear, if you are swimming the English Channel, at some point, there's not enough oxygen getting to your cells because your muscles are working so hard. So your cells shift out of cellular respiration in purple, which requires oxygen, to aerobic glycolysis in yellow, which can happen in the absence of oxygen. And the buildup, as you can see, is lactic acid. And then when you stop exercising, running, or swimming, and you have to catch your breath and you're panting, your body is actually now trying to take all that lactic acid that's built up and trying to convert it back or flush it through. So this is the process that cells go through when there's not a lot of oxygen. And it's not very efficient. Going from pyruvate to lactic acid gets you 2 ATP molecules. Pyruvate to lactic acid, 2, versus pyruvate to carbon dioxide, 32, 33, 34, 35. So this is not the process your cells normally go through. Amazingly, this is the process many of your cancer cells go through. Those that don't have enough oxygen default to this, but even those that have enough oxygen often default to this, what looks like an incredibly ineffective pathway. But here's where cancer cells, again, have acquired mutations, and those mutations have benefited them, that makes this glycolysis pathway make sense for them. Here's the first mutation that happens. And this is called the Warburg effect because it was first identified by a scientist named Otto Warburg back in the late 1800s, I think. So we've known about the Warburg effect for a while. Maybe not necessarily its role in cancer. One of the first things that happens is cancer cells acquire mutations that allows them to drastically increase the amount of glucose those cells take in. So now the cancer cell, essentially what it does is it increases the number of molecules that sit in the cell, on the cell membrane, and let glucose in. So we increase by 20-fold the amount of glucose that's coming into the cells. And then the cells have acquired ways to be incredibly efficient in how they move from pyruvate to lactate, so that they are producing ATP through this pathway 100 times more efficiently than another non-cancer cell would be using this pathway. So they're using this pathway incredibly efficiently, and they've got an enormous amount of glucose flying through the door. So they actually are producing more ATP than a typical cell would be that has access to oxygen and is going through cellular respiration. So we're getting huge amounts of energy. And it takes ATP in order for us to replicate DNA, in order for us to go through the cell cycle and divide. And they are massing up stockpiles of it. It's like Apple and its amount of, the amount of cash that Apple sits on. This is the cancer cell. I did not just equate Apple to a cancer. Let's be real clear about that. But it is just amassing huge amounts of ATP because it's going to burn through it quickly as it's going through cell division. Along the way, this process going from pyruvate to lactic acid actually produces a lot of intermediates, a lot of other chemicals along the way, and those chemicals form the building blocks for cell membranes, for the specific cell structures that are needed to help the cell move through mitosis, and for the initial building blocks of DNA that are used when you replicate, when you copy your DNA. So this process, shifting their metabolism from oxidative phosphorylation, from cellular respiration, to the upper pathway, to anaerobic glycolysis, is incredibly beneficial to the cancer cell. It gives it lots of energy, and it gives it all the intermediates that it's going to need as it makes new cells. Now, we can take advantage of this. I should have also mentioned, mutations in other hallmarks actually also upregulate this process. So as I am affecting, as I'm recruiting other blood vessels, as I am turning on go signals, come on out, the weather is fine, the byproduct of that is actually also forcing us down this energy metabolism pathway. Now, we can take advantage of knowing that cancer cells shift their metabolism in a couple of ways. One, we can use it for diagnosing cancer. So if we have a sense that an individual has a cancer and we want to identify exactly where that cancer is by scanning, it's very difficult sometimes to see a cancer on a standard MRI or on a CT scan. But if we know that cancer cells are drastically increasing the amount of glucose they take up, some really smart scientists and clinicians figured out that they could take a glucose molecule and attach a radioactive tracer to it. And when the cell takes up, when the cancer cells preferentially take up that glucose in an fMRI, in a specific type of MRI, you actually can see which cells are gathering, are accumulating that radioactive glucose. So here's an example in the image behind me. This is a PET scan using the radioactive glucose, and you can see two things. So the image is actually showing you of an individual lying in the fMRI. The black spaces are the air spaces where the lungs are. The kidneys are these two organs down here that have the K and the arrow. Kidneys naturally take up lots of glucose, and you can see the yellow, they have taken up the radioactive dye. So that's to be expected. But you can see in the structure just above the kidney on the left-hand side of the image, this is the liver, and you can see two spots, one in the upper part of the liver and one down in the lower lobe that also have this orange bright halo. Those are tumors. And those tumors have preferentially taken up this radioactive glucose. So knowing that cancer cells have shifted their metabolism and are rapidly taking up the glucose is a way for us to detect it and a way for us to track it as we begin therapy, to begin following, are these tumors shrinking over time as we expose them to therapy? Barb. That's a really good question. So the question was, if these cancer cells have shifted to aerobic glycolysis and they are making much, much more lactic acid, can we detect that they're making more lactic acid with a blood test? Would we be able to pick up an increased amount of lactic acid? I don't know, but I do know that what often happens is that the lactic acid actually is excreted out of some of the cancer cells and actually serves as a metabolic fuel for other cancer cells. They take in lactic acid and then they break it down through the process and generate energy from it. So I don't know how much of it actually would overspill into the bloodstream and how much of it is just being passed around to other cancer cell neighbors to take in as an energy source. But I think that's a really good question. I'll see if I can find an answer for that. Other questions?
So you use the term precancerous. Is that a discrete transition or is that a continuum? How do the hallmarks differ between the two categories and what drives whether it transitions or doesn't?
So the good question. The question is, I talked about precancer. Is there a discrete difference between precancer and cancer? And how do the hallmarks differ? And what's the process that essentially takes us from normal to precancer to cancer? So precancer is a term that's used to describe cells that look disorganized, that no longer look like a typical cell does, but have not yet acquired the ability to spread and metastasize. Because if you remember back to our first session, the full definition of cancer is cells that have acquired the ability to invade into surrounding tissue and metastasize. So precancer cells have acquired many of these hallmarks, or are in the process of acquiring these hallmarks, but have not acquired the hallmark to metastasize. So it is not necessarily a discrete, it is not a, today I look like this and tomorrow I've now become cancer. You can't see that under the, you can't necessarily, it's not a black-white shift, It is a much more gradual transition from one stage to the next. Yes, sir.
What is the impact on the other line that you have there? Carbon dioxide.
So what is the impact?
The cellular respiration.
In other words, do cells still go down that road? Or most of the cancer cells preferentially choose the aerobic glycolysis. In some of the studies, there are some cancer cells that actually stay with aerobic, with oxidative phosphorylation with the bottom half. Some tumor cells, even though there's enough oxygen and they could use cellular respiration, they preferentially use aerobic glycolysis because it gets them more ATP at the end of the day. The cells, the typical cells surrounding it, are still using that bottom pathway. Anybody, any others?
I have a question, but it's back to the...
back to inflammation?
Yes, exactly. Thank you.
Okay.
I get a test with my normal yearly checkup called a C-reactive protein test, and normally that's very, very low. And do you have a minute to explain?
So the question is, do I have a minute to explain the C-reactive protein test?
Yeah, for inflammation.
For inflammation. And I have no knowledge of what that is, Gary. So there we go. So that was not even a minute to explain. But yeah, nope. Sorry. I can try to find that out. But off the top of my head, I would just be making something up to tell you a story. So just move on. That's right. Yes, ma'am. This is actually being done in low oxygen, so yeah, I probably have that wrong up there. That would probably, I'm going to have my handy-dandy team with their laptop access that will be texting me. Just let me know if I've really messed that up and if that really should be anaerobic glycolysis or not. So thank you for catching that, and once they let me know, then we'll go from there. Question from our online audience. If inflammation feeds the fire of cancer, how much do chronic inflammation diseases like lupus increase the chance of aggressive cancer as compared to someone with no inflammatory disease? So we're going to be at the edge of my knowledge, but I know that many of these chronic inflammation syndromes do tend to increase the risk of cancer, but it doesn't seem to be global increases in cancer. It seems to be very specific, like the chronic gastroesophageal reflux specifically increases the risk of esophageal cancer. So let me see if I can dig into that some more, and when we come back on Tuesday, I'll see if I've got an answer for that. It's also a good question. Yes, so you guys are doing a great job at Stump Dr. Lamb tonight. That is fantastic. I'm really glad we got a smaller audience here. No, I'm just joking. Yes, sir.
What are the causes of inflammation that's listed as lack of exercise? How does that work?
One of the causes of inflammation that's listed is lack of exercise. How does that work? Yeah, so we're just going to keep on going here with one more. I can tell you what I think, but I'm not 100% certain that what I think is right, and so I'm just going to keep my mouth shut and come back and give you the right answer for that on Tuesday. You can ask the inverse of that, but I might give you the exact same answer, but go for it.
So what about long-term high-intensity exercise where you create a lot of lactic acid?
Long-term, where you're creating lots of lactic acid on an ongoing basis, and where you are, where you're creating lots of micro tears. I was going down that road from the inflammation perspective. You're going down that road from the energy perspective. You pretty quickly flip that switch back. So it is a relatively quick return, getting rid of that lactic acid and metabolizing that lactic acid. So I haven't seen any associations with long-term high-energy exercise and cancer through this pathway. All right, I'm going to move on before somebody else asks me a question that I don't know. No, actually, I love the fact that you ask such great questions. You're really thinking through this. You're not just passively sitting there. So here is a way that people are beginning to think about this in terms of therapy. Glycolysis inhibitors. So glycolysis inhibitors disrupt this energy conversion. And the thinking is, if we can starve the cancer by reducing their ability to get all the ATP that they need, is that going to make a difference? Is that going to help us as we try to look at treatments of the cancer? So this is done in a couple of ways. One way is that you actually block or reduce the access to glucose. So you actually get less glucose into the cell. One of the drugs that's being looked at for this is a drug called metformin. It's a common diabetic drug. Same thing, in diabetes, you're reducing the amount of glucose that's coming into the cells because you are, with type 2 diabetes, you're increasing your glucose levels because you're less and less responsive to the impact of insulin. Metformin, the thinking is the same thing. If we have less glucose coming into the cancer cells, then there's less raw material for them to then shuttle down this pathway. Another option is actually to disrupt the process, the conversion of glucose to pyruvate and pyruvate onto the lactic acid. So there are a couple of other drugs that are currently being looked at that block these other pathways. One of them, for example, is a glucose lookalike that gets brought into the cell, but then it gets started in the pathway and it blocks the pathway from going any further. Now the challenge with this is you don't want to give this system wide. Because the rest of your cells, they still need glucose. The ones that are going through oxidative phosphorylation, cellular respiration, they still need glucose. So you don't want every cell in your body now being denied access to glucose. So how do you keep this from being a systemic issue? These are really early in development. Probably of almost everything that I'm talking to you about with these hallmarks, this is one of the earliest, in part because it's one of the most challenging. Every cell has to have access to glucose and has to be able to make energy from it. And when you start tinkering with the process of making energy, you run the risk of really causing major problems across the entire body. The other interesting piece, if you look at this, is the current top three drugs, or the anti-diabetic drug that I told you about, the modified glucose molecule, and then this other molecule that's used as a doping agent in athletics. As you might imagine, there's a lot of reluctance to use a doping medicine that's outlawed by all sports authorities, all sports organizations, as an anti-cancer treatment. We'll see. We'll see how that comes out. Again, that's really early stage stuff. All right, that's our second of the three. Now let's talk about the third one. I am fascinated by this one. I knew almost nothing about the relationship of the immune system and cancer when I started prepping for this series. And I am just, it sounds awful to say I'm enamored about how cancer forms, and I don't mean it that way, but I'm amazed at what I'm about to tell you that takes place inside your cells with your immune system. On Tuesday night, somebody said, this sounds a little bit like science fiction. This sounds even more like science fiction. So avoiding destruction by the immune system. Cancer cells actually acquire additional mutations. Remember, cancer cells are continually acquiring mutations. And some of these mutations are in random places throughout the genome that have no impact at all. And periodically, some of these mutations actually happen to be in genes, in the recipes. And if some of these mutations in these recipes give the cancer cell an advantage, a growth advantage, then that's going to be something that is maintained as that cell grows even faster and has a better chance of dividing, and the cells that divide from it will have maintained that as well. So some of these mutations allow the cancer to completely slip under the nose of the immune system. The immune system normally does a great job of recognizing things that don't belong. But sometimes cancer has figured out how to pull the wool over the eyes of our immune system. And cancer cells that have become what's called immunoevasive, so they've evaded the immune system, can just take off and grow unchecked. And in many cases, when we get to those rapid growth stages of cancer, that's exactly what's happened. They have evaded the immune system. All right. I showed you this image the first night. It is really true with what I'm about to talk about. I am about to give you major, major oversimplifications about how the immune system works. So if you know the immune system really well, I apologize. I'm going to talk in very, very broad brushstrokes, but still I hope maintain the key piece of what's going on. All right, so the immune system, one of the things the immune system does is it recognizes unusual proteins that are produced maybe by viruses or by bacteria, things that don't belong. Now, as your cancer cells acquire mutations, and some of those mutations are in genes, are in recipes, as they change the protein recipe, the proteins the cancer cells are producing are now themselves unusual. They're a little different than what the typical gene, than what the normal gene would have produced. So some of these proteins, as your cancer cells die, these proteins are expelled out into the space around the cells. Some of these proteins that your cancer cells are producing actually are broken up into pieces and they're stuck on the outside of the cancer cells. So any foreign protein, any protein piece, I shouldn't say foreign, any protein piece that can be recognized by the immune system is called an antigen. So an antigen is some bit of a molecule, some bit of a protein, for example, that your immune system can find and say, huh, I wonder where this came from. Cancer cells make what are called neoantigens. New antigens, new protein pieces that are not normally found thanks to the fact that they've acquired these mutations, that they've changed these recipes. And some of these neoantigens are put on the outside of cells, much like you might put on a hat. Now remember, I talked about methyl caps in our first week, those things that bind the DNA and they condense down the DNA. I want you to take that cap analogy and stick it off to the side. I'm now talking about hats that sit on the outside of cells, not things that are on the DNA inside the nucleus. So, a cap. This is an unusual cap. You would not see a lot of this if you were walking down the street. This is the example of a neoantigen. This is a way that a cancer cell unknowingly identifies itself as a little bit unusual. And so the immune system recognizes these unusual cells and says, huh, I've not seen that before. And then goes and activates other immune cells and says, hey, if you see this, this is problematic. We probably need to attack this. Now, this image that's on the screen behind me tells that in a much more scientifically appropriate way. And I realize you can't see it because the hat is in the way. But this image, essentially, if we start at about 6:30 or 7 o'clock, cancer cells are releasing their antigens, some of which are on the outside of the cancer cells. And then there are cells that pick up these antigens and say, huh, that looks interesting. I wonder what that is. And they then activate other cells. The cell we're going to talk most about tonight that they activate is called a T cell. There are lots of different functions of T cells, but one of the functions of the T cells is that it actually recognizes these antigens, these foreign proteins, and it triggers an immune response against something that's got these foreign proteins. Now, T cells have to be trained so that they know, oh wait, that hat is part of the normal cell. My cells wear that hat all the time. I can ignore that. I've never seen this hat before. I think this is problematic. So the T cells are trained. They're trained in certain parts of your body like the thymus. And then they travel through the bloodstream and they infiltrate into your tissues. And if they find a cell that wears this hat, they program or they ensure its death and destruction. This is a more complicated version. You don't have this version of the picture in your slides just because it isn't, you don't need to have it. These are all genes involved in each one of these processes. This is an incredibly complicated process. But again, key thing to remember, neoantigens, unusual molecules, the immune system says, hey, I've not seen that before. T cells go look for that. They then bind and say, oh, you're wearing the hat. I need to kill you, or we need to get rid of you. Thank you very much. You need to be destroyed. All right. So this process that I'm going to tell you, that I'm going to describe for you, is called immunoediting. And it starts with completely normal cells. And these normal cells over time, acquire mutations. This is exactly what we've been talking about for the last three sessions. And they acquire these mutations because of environmental factors like tobacco smoke or asbestos or ultraviolet light, or they acquire them through chronic inflammation, like we talked about just a few minutes ago, or viral infections. And the acquiring of those mutations converts these cells into cancer cells. And you can see these cancer cells are identified as being almost reddish orange, as opposed to the normal cells that are tan in color. So there are three phases of this process, this dance between cancer cells and the immune system. The first phase is elimination. It's what I just described. The T cells and the other cells recognize the neoantigen hats, the hallmark calling card of cancer cells. They attack them, they destroy them, and the vast majority of the cells actually are now normal. We've gotten rid of our cancer cells. Your immune system does this all the time. I think we talked about this maybe the first week. Your immune system is continually recognizing tiny cancers and destroying and getting rid of them. That's phase one, that's elimination. However, sometimes every cancer cell doesn't get eliminated. And the cells that don't get eliminated enter into phase two, which is called equilibrium. And in equilibrium, there's a really small number of cancer cells. And those cancer cells grow, the growth of those cancer cells often slows way down. And so periodically they grow and divide, they slow the signaling down, and they acquire more mutations. This can be months, this may even potentially be years that they're in this almost dormancy phase, this equilibrium phase. Over time, they are acquiring new mutations. And some of these mutations change the neoantigens, change the hat. A neoantigen like this is clearly going to get recognized and destroyed. A mutation that creates a neoantigen more like this. This is a hat that comes from a northern part of India. You would probably not see this on a whole lot of heads walking down the streets of North Alabama. If your cell, if we're following the analogy, this is a different mutation, this is still pretty abnormal. The cell's gonna recognize it and go, yeah, that's not a, that shouldn't be there, and destroy that. Probably also something that the cell's gonna recognize as abnormal. Not a whole lot of people in North Alabama walking down wearing hats from Greece. This cell's gonna get destroyed by the immune system. This is a South Carolina cap. That's probably still pretty rare here in North Alabama, but not so entirely rare that it's never been seen before. The immune system's probably gonna pay some attention to this, but maybe not. Pretty colorful, nothing that would necessarily draw your attention. The immune system might actually ignore this, might just say, no, that's not any big deal. The immune system sees a whole lot of these and says, oh, I know what that is, everybody's got those. That's my, that's me, those are my cells. I don't need to worry about that. But only one of them's normal, for those of you at home that didn't hear that. So, the immune system lets this slide. But this is actually a cancer cell, that the cancer cell has acquired a mutation that has changed the antigens on the surface. And so now it doesn't look foreign. It doesn't look unusual. It has become immune evasive. And now we're at the third stage. And the third stage is escape. So at this point now, those cells that have acquired those mutations that mean they fly below the radar of the immune system, they now take off. They're under no kinds of regulation, and they divide and they are off to the races. And this is when the cancer really grows out of control. So that entire process in words is on this slide. Here's the entire process with a totally different image, where you can see the tan cells are the normal cells, The orange or reddish cells are the cancer cells that are highly immunogenic. So the immune system goes, whoa, you're a cancer cell, I gotta get rid of you. We enter into the equilibrium stage. There's a small number of cancer cells. You can see them here as an orange, as a brown, and a purple cell in this middle image. The brown cells are immunogenic poor. They're recognized, but not very much. That might be like the equivalent of the South Carolina cap or the cap with all the different colors on it. And then as they acquire more mutations, more and more of the purple cells that are immunoevasive take place. And the immune system thinks everything is great. The immune system's on high alert, but it doesn't see the cancer that's right under its nose because the cancer has found a way to cloak itself, to mask itself from the immune system. And then off it goes. I gotta tell you, I find that interplay between cancer and the immune system horribly fascinating, horrifically fascinating, that it finds, that it acquires these mutations that give it a selective advantage, that give it a growth advantage. It's not being picked up by the immune system and killed, and that's what we deal with. So often, by the time you've got a cancer that has really grown out of control, now not always, this doesn't always happen. Sometimes cancers grow so very, very rapidly, even when they're highly immune recognized. They just swamp the immune system. But in this other case, when we're all the way over here, your immune system has just shut down. I mean, your immune system's is almost in like cold storage. It doesn't even recognize what's going on. So this opens the door to something called immunotherapy. Immunotherapy was what Science Magazine called in 2013 the breakthrough of the year. And it's what I'm going to talk about tonight as our bench to bedside piece. But before I do that, because I've just given you a lot of information, let me stop and see if you've got questions that I can't answer. Gary.
Can you go back to that slide?
That one?
So, I'm a total novice. Does the cancer, after elimination, recognize that it's been picked on, and somehow the DNA inside the cancer cells kind of says, "Okay, hold it. Time out for a second. Let's cool out for a second and grow slower, but we're still gonna, evade."
Yeah, so the question is about this dormancy phase.
Right.
What is it that causes the cancer cells to say, okay, we're going to slow down,
right,
and we're gonna hunker down and just wait? That is one of the questions of dormancy. That's one of the questions of immunoediting that hasn't yet been solved. What is it that takes a cancer cell that has been up until now growing like gangbusters, growing rapidly, and what is it that has it, what holds it back? I haven't found any insight yet into what those cell signals are.
May I ask you one unfair question?
You may ask me one unfair question. You certainly may.
Either from a scientific, biological, evolutionary standpoint, or from a theological standpoint, why
so the question is, from either a biological perspective or a theological perspective, why do we have these awful mutating cancer cells that do such a good job of evading the body's defense system? Fair?
Yes.
All right. That was half of it.
That's half of the question.
Oh, that's half of the question. So you're going to ask me one unfair question and then ask me another unfair question as well? All right, well, let me answer that question because I think that's a valuable question. Life depends on cells' ability to respond to their environment, grow when conditions are favorable, and create more cells. I think the drive for cell division and for cell growth is a fundamental factor of life on Earth. And that process is driven by our DNA, by the recipes within our genetic code. Because we live long periods of time, our cells are exposed to a number of different factors, especially in today's society, that damage our DNA. If we were living 15,000 years ago, and we were most of our skin was continually exposed to ultraviolet light, and we didn't have the dark pigment of our African ancestors, and we lived past the age of 20, we would all be developing skin cancer. We live in a world where we have lots and lots of exposures, and our cells undergo lots and lots of cell divisions and copying. And mistakes in our DNA are made, and more often than not, they're caught. But cancer is a fundamental feature of age. Now, I know people get cancer when they're very young, and there are other, they have a particularly unlucky set of mutations that they either acquire or that they're born with, or something else that we're going to talk about next week. But cancer occurs, our DNA mutates because we just make random mistakes every time we copy 3 billion bits of information, and because we live in an environment that continually assaults and damages that DNA. And any mutation that gives the cell an advantage in growth, that mutation is going to allow that cell to thrive, and it's going to be carried into the next set of cell divisions. So in some ways, that is, on a tiny micro scale, that is the whole concept of evolution. Mutations occur, and if it's in a favorable advantage, that mutation gains a selective advantage. So it is a part of what it means to actually be alive. Now, I know somebody's going to say, sharks don't get cancer, they're alive. You know, this plant doesn't get cancer, it's alive, and I agree with that. There are probably some biological factors that are actually protective, but as human beings with the trillions of cells that we have in the world that we walk around with, it is going to be a natural consequence, which is why 1 in 2 men and 1 in 3 women develop cancer over the course of their lifetime. Your other unfair question? Oh, there was the unfair part. What's the theological examination? That is a conversation that I am happy to have with you probably offline. And I just got a text from my phenomenal folks in the background. So the slide that shows, I won't go all the way back. The yellow section, this is to your point. That is anaerobic, moving from pyruvate to lactic. Moving from glucose to pyruvate and from pyruvate down to CO2, that is the aerobic. So it should say anaerobic. That moving from pyruvate to lactic acid should be anaerobic. My fault. You have another question. Are you going to mess me? Are you going to tell me something's wrong on this slide? Go for it.
And this is probably an easy question. During that equilibrium phase, could a cancerous tumor be detected by a PET scan?
During that equilibrium phase, could a cancerous tumor be detected by a PET scan, like the one I showed you, I don't know, because I don't know how many cells we're actually talking about. I don't know if this dormant phase actually escapes traditional detection. And I don't know if it would actually escape liquid biopsies like we talked about in the first week. I don't know how many actual cells we're specifically talking about at this point. Much of the work that I'm telling you has happened in animal models, where you actually can clearly study, you know where the tumor is because you actually caused the tumor, you implanted the tumor in some cases, and you're following it. There's been enough evidence in humans that says this is true, but I don't know that we actually are able to answer, just like the dormancy question that Gary asked, I don't know that we're able to answer that piece yet.
Is equilibrium another way of saying remission?
Is equilibrium another way of saying remission?
Well,
okay. So I think that a part of that question is yes. So you are treated for cancer and you are declared cancer-free. But in many cases, evidence suggests there are still tiny seed cells or cancer stem cells, and we'll talk about this, we'll talk about cancer stem cells next week with metastasis, that still are hanging out in some little niche in your body, not doing much. And then some signal causes it to flare back up. And often the cancer, the recurrence has acquired a new set of mutations compared to what the primary tumor was. So I don't know if equilibrium, I think equilibrium happens pre-remission in the process of, all right, now we have identified the cancer and now we're going to treat it. But I think a similar process may also happen once you've treated it, you've been declared cancer-free, and then the cancer may recur later on. Yes, Sue.
This is kind of on that point, but if the DNA is damaged or mutated, the DNA is mutated, and you form cancer, and then you go through your treatment process, and like you said, you're cancer-free, but the mutation is still always there, is that right? Unless it's mutated again?
So the question is, if you've got cells and they get mutated and they become cancer and then you're treated for cancer and you're declared cancer free, is the mutation still there? Right? Am I hearing you correctly?
So the DNA is still mutated, correct?
The DNA is still mutated, but if you're truly cancer free, you have killed all the cancer causing cells, which are the cells that have acquired the mutation. Now, I don't know if you remember, but the very first night I talked about something called tumor heterogeneity, which is the fact that if you look at a tumor, you've actually got populations of cells with multiple different combinations of mutations. When they talk about, in surgery for cancer, they talk about getting clean margins. They are not only taking the tumor, but they're taking cells around the tumor that may look slightly disorganized, and they actually are going into getting even, taking out even typical-looking, normal-looking cells, because some of those cells around the margins may have acquired 1, 2, 3 of the 8 mutations that the tumor in the center had. So they're intentionally trying to take as many of the surrounding cells that may be at a pre-cancer stage as well. So let me circle this back to your question. Is the DNA mutation still there? Depends on if any of those cells escaped destruction or being surgically removed. So if it's a cell that was one of the early ones that got the mutation but hasn't acquired 5 others, and it's outside them, it's outside what the margins were, it could still be there. But generally, if it's a cancer cell and the cancer drugs and the chemotherapy and the surgery took all the cancer, which again brings us back to what we'll talk about next week with, are there cancer stem cells left behind, if you got all of it, then you should have gotten all the cells that contained those mutations. Okay, so I'm going to move us on. I'm going to talk about immunotherapy. So this is a treatment that either initiates the body's immune response or reinitiates the body's immune response, assuming that you're at this stage where the immune system has gone, has missed what's going on with the cancer. The cancer has cloaked itself. And you want to do this, you want to activate an immune response without activating such a strong immune response that you then generate an autoimmune response. You don't want the body to turn on, you need the body to turn on its own cells that have become cancerous without going overboard and turning on its own cells that are not cancerous, attacking its own cells. More than 50% of current U.S. clinical trials involve some form of immunotherapy. So this has become big news in clinical trials. You see a lot of immunotherapy. And there are 2 different ways that immunotherapy is put into place. The first on the top is to directly target the tumor with generally with antibodies, which are produced by the immune system, with antibodies that bind to tumor cells and signal their destruction. The other way, which is seen below that in green, is to activate the immune cells that specifically will then go and find the cancer. So there are two different, I want you to understand the difference. I am directly attacking the tumor versus I am activating the immune cells, so the immune system will then go and attack the tumor. So let's look at those. So let's start with the ones that target the tumor. These are primarily antibodies, especially monoclonal antibodies. I talked about these in the first session. These are Y-shaped molecules, Y-shaped proteins produced by the cell, and on the tips, they have all different kinds of gloves. They bind all different kinds of antigens. So think about the difference between a baseball glove and a hockey glove and a lacrosse glove. Each of them grabs a different shape ball or puck. The ends of the monoclonal antibody recognize different kinds of antigens, different kinds of these foreign proteins. They're looking for specific hats. Each antibody looks for a different kind of hat. You can have just plain antibodies. These are called naked antibodies because they're not attached to anything, and they are looking for a specific protein, a specific hat, like Avastin, which we talked about the very first session. Avastin is used to block blood vessel growth because it binds that VEGF protein that is what normally signals to the cells, hey, we need to sprout some new blood vessels. So the monoclonal antibody, Avastin, binds VEGF protein and prevents it from signaling the cell. We can also talk about monoclonal antibodies that recognize proteins that sit on the surface of cells. So with breast cancer, some forms of breast cancer are called HER2 positive because they contain an overabundance of receptors that sit on the outside of the cell that are called HER2 receptors that signal for growth. Herceptin is an antibody that looks for all of these HER2 receptors and binds it. And when it binds it, it prevents it from signaling for growth, and it also signals that this cell ultimately needs to be destroyed. So those are naked antibodies. They're made in a lab, they're made specifically to target unknown protein, and then you administer them. You can also have what are called conjugated antibodies. So these are antibodies that are attached to something else. And the examples that I've got on the screen, one of them is an antibody that is attached to a radioactive molecule. So you are delivering radioactivity right to the cancer cell because you know that this cancer cell has this specific hat on it, and you have targeted your antibody and its radioactive molecule to go right to the hat. Another one actually is the antibody conjugated attached to chemotherapy or some other toxin. So I am now delivering a toxin, I'm delivering poison right to the cancer cell, and I am looking only for the cells that have those hats. Now it's really important that the kind of hat you're looking for is primarily found only on your cancer cells. Because if you're delivering a toxic drug and you're looking for a hat that's found on all kinds of other cells, this is a problem. You need to find these unique neoantigens that are present just on the cancer cells. And then there's a whole other kind of monoclonal antibody that actually is called a bispecific antibody. And it does two things. It binds the hat, and it also binds an immune cell. So it brings an immune cell to the cancer cell. It brings them in close proximity. It's like, hey, let me introduce you to, please kill this cell. So those are monoclonal antibodies. Their goal is to target the tumor directly. Now let's look at the other side. Let's look at immunotherapy that activates immune cells. This is some really exciting, pretty new kinds of therapies. Checkpoint inhibitor drugs. All right, the process of a cell saying, oh, of an immune cell saying, oh, look, that's a hat I haven't seen before. And then saying to a T cell, hey, you need to go find this hat, and when you find this hat, you need to kill that cell. That process is actually blocked by proteins that are called checkpoints. They kind of put the handcuffs on the immune cells, and only when the checkpoints are taken off can the immune cells say, hey, you're looking for that hat, or hey, you're wearing that hat, I need to trigger your destruction. So these new immunotherapies are called checkpoint inhibitor drugs. And essentially what they do is they take off the handcuffs. They take off the brakes that normally have kept the immune system in check. So you can see this image behind me, this bluish-gray cell, this is a dendrite. It is what is saying to the T cell, hey, you need to look for this hat. And here's the checkpoint. So this little molecule right here is the inhibitor drug. It prevents the checkpoint from binding to the T cell and holding it in, blocking it. The drug, the inhibitor, prevents this interaction and allows the dendritic cell to say to the T cell, go look for that hat. In the same way, here's an interaction between a T cell in yellow and a cancer cell in purple. And there's another checkpoint right here. And when the checkpoint is active, it prevents the T cell from acting and destroying the cancer cell. So the checkpoint gets in between them and prevents the checkpoint from holding everything back. It takes off the boxing glove, takes off the handcuffs. So these checkpoint inhibitor drugs are quickly becoming a really important part of treatments for both melanoma and non-small cell lung cancer. And they are seeing remission rates that are amazing, that are like 50, 60, 70, 80%, depending on the specific type of study. And in many cases, it's because you've now freed the immune system to now recognize and act on the hats. And not just these hats, but potentially even the South Carolina hat. That's a little unusual, but maybe not totally unusual. Does it learn for next time, or does the cancer go in remission?
What I mean is that...
Does the checkpoint still try to function?
Yeah,
I think the checkpoint still tries to function. I don't know that for certain. The next therapy I'm going to show you, I think, does allow you to move past that. But I think you still... I think that the... You know, Gary, let me take that back. I'm not 100% certain. All right, here are two more therapies. This is chimeric antigen receptor T cell therapy. That's a mouthful, so they just call it by the first letters, C-A-R, so CAR T cell therapy, or sometimes it's called CAR T therapy, and then tumor infiltrating lymphocyte therapy as well. In a nutshell, here's what they do. Each of them takes T cells out of your body. So we take a sample of blood, we get a whole bunch of T cells. Each one of those T cells is looking for a different hat. We can sort and screen them and say, I know that your tumor is wearing this hat. I'm now looking for the T cell that recognizes that hat. And I'm going to grow that specific T cell in the lab until I have lots and lots and thousands of T cells looking for that hat. And then I'm going to give it back to you. And now I have given you an army ready-made that knows exactly what it is looking for, and it is prepped and primed, and it attacks those cancer cells. In a different way, something similar is I take the T cells and I actually can engineer what I'm looking for. I can engineer the glove at the end to look for the specific hat that your cancer is producing if I don't find that T cell in your system. So in some cases, I'm just naturally enhancing what you've got. In other cases, I'm actually engineering specifically a T cell that is going to attack your cancer. These are incredibly promising immunotherapies, especially for lymphomas and melanomas. And they're now being looked at only through clinical trials. But these clinical trials are really promising, and many of them are beginning to get fast-tracked or rapid. They're being moved rapidly through the process. Some of you actually talked to me about this on Tuesday. On Monday and Tuesday, a whole set of posts went around on Facebook about these amazing advances in cancer therapy. It came from an article in The Guardian. This is exactly what that article is talking about. It's talking about these specific T-cell therapies and how phenomenal they look. people are seeing remission rates, again, 60, 70, 80%. And these are remission rates for cancers that have failed many other types of therapy. So there's a lot of enthusiasm about the potential for what immunotherapies may actually do. Which brings me to another part of immunotherapy that is not as successful, and that is cancer vaccines. We've talked a lot, scientists have talked a lot about cancer vaccines and have very little to show for it. There are two key types of vaccines. One are vaccines that prevent cancer. We've talked a couple times tonight already about certain viruses that if you are infected with these viruses, they drastically increase the likelihood you will develop cancer. So the HPV virus, the human papillomavirus, certain subtypes of the human papillomavirus, if you are infected with them, they dramatically increase a woman's risk for cervical cancer, and they increase risk of other types of cancer across both genders. The HBV, hepatitis B virus, dramatically increases your risk of liver cancer. So we can design vaccines against these viruses. So this is no different than the flu vaccine, or a vaccine against malaria, or hopefully someday a vaccine against Ebola and Zika virus. These work by prepping your body to say, if you see this virus, immediately mount a response to it. Immediately turn the immune system on and prevent a systemic infection. So those vaccines, the HPV virus, which is offered to boys and girls, specifically is designed to prevent them from getting this virus and then reducing their risk of cancer because they won't get the virus. That's different from a virus that is specifically designed to treat the cancer. This is actually trying to prime the immune system to recognize cells wearing hats before or early on in the cancer development. And there have been a lot of work looking at these. There's only one that even exists on the market right now that's FDA approved, and it's for prostate cancer. And the side effects are pretty severe, and a whole lot of physicians, a whole lot of oncologists actually feel like the vaccine causes more problem than living with the cancer. So it doesn't get treated, it doesn't get used very much. We've spent a lot of time and a lot of money on trying to develop cancer vaccines without a lot to show for it, except that we now understand much more about how the immune system works, which has opened the door for these immunotherapies that I've just told you about. So there is a benefit to that, but I don't know that we're gonna see a lot of cancer vaccines that are gonna really have much promise down the road. If you wanna dig into this from a lay perspective, the Wall Street Journal has a great series of articles under the heading of Cancer Super Survivors, How the Promise of Immunotherapy is Transforming Oncology. And so if you just want to search that, it's a great website that tells the stories of a number of people whose lives have been dramatically altered because of these different immunotherapies. And it digs into monoclonal antibodies, and it digs into these T-cell therapies as well. So if you want more with a great human perspective, I would encourage you to take a look at those articles. All right, so this brings us to the last section tonight, where I talk about some work that's going on at Hudson Alpha. This is really cool stuff. And I'm worried that I'm not gonna do it justice because it's complicated, but I want you to hear this. So hang with me. Shake off the cobwebs for just a minute. I promise I'm not gonna keep you too much longer. So this is work by Dr. Jin Han, one of our faculty investigators, and one of the most entrepreneurial individuals at Hudson Alpha. So Dr. Han has a history of starting companies. Right now, there are three companies at the Institute that bear his fingerprints and his work in some way, shape, fashion, or form. iRepertoire, iCubate, and Diatherix. He is fascinated with studying the immune system. And many of the things that we've talked about are things that he looks at. How is the immune system carrying that careful balance that it is catching when you've got things wrong and destroying them without leading you into autoimmune disorders? What are the issues going on? How is your immune system continually surveying the landscape, looking for what's happening? The three images that are behind me will lay the groundwork for what we're going to talk about for the next two or three slides. So on the left, this piece on antibody specificity, this is what I've been talking about when I've been talking about the different kinds of gloves and then the different things that those gloves recognize, or when I talked about the different hats that are recognized. That same kind of specificity that I've talked about for antibodies also is involved in proteins that sit on the immune system cells for your B cells and your T cells. So your B cell receptors and your T cell receptors. They've also got these fingers, and these fingers have unique, each T cell recognizes a different hat or looks for a different hat. And there are billions with a B, billions of different potential combinations for what each of your T cells and B cells can recognize. So I want you to contemplate that for a second. Billions of different combinations of hats that your cells are looking for. And these cells have to go through a training period to say, oh, nope, that hat, that's a normal part of us. You're gone. I don't want you attacking a normal part of us. Yep, that's not part of us. Let's hold you in reserve. So the goal is to have a really diverse immune system that can recognize all different kinds of hats, all different kinds of things that you might be exposed to. So what Dr. Hahn has done in the slides that I'm going to show you, he specifically worked with T cell receptors all the way over here on the right. And he's looking at these fingertips, the sections that represent hats. And he's looking genetically at the genetic combinations that give you all these different recognition sites. So he takes 1,000 individuals and he looks at their T cell receptors, and he goes back and studies what are the genetic combinations that let you recognize different hats across your T cell. So he is saying for each individual, so for Gary, he's looking at the T cell receptors that are active in your body right now, and he's looking at all the different hats that your T cell receptors could recognize. And he's comparing your T cell receptors to mine and to Sue's and to everybody, and to the 1,000 people in his study. Everybody with me on that? Good. We're looking at the diversity of hat recognition. So here's what he's found. 1,000 people, when he looks at the universe of what their T cell receptors recognize, in blue, 81% of the hats are private. Each individual on their own is the only one that has that hat recognition. 81% of the total hats that he identifies are private and only present in one person. Now that's a little mind-boggling. Here's one way I want you to think about it. If I've got a protein, and that protein is found inside the influenza virus, I can break that protein up into lots of little pieces, and each one of those little pieces is a hat that my immune system could recognize. So Gary and I may both be able to recognize this year's crop of influenza virus, but he's recognizing one part of the protein, and I'm recognizing a hat that represents a different part of the protein. But we are uniquely looking at those hats, 81%. The red slice are barely shared. So, let's back up. Are shared by 2 to 3 people out of the 1,000 that he looked at. The green section are a little more shared. They're shared by between 4 and 100 people. So between 4 and 100 people out of these 1,000 people have a T cell receptor that identifies the same hat. And then there's a relatively small fraction, less than 1%, but still hundreds of different hats that are shared across almost 90% of the population. So there's a really tiny fraction of hats that we all recognize. There's a small fraction that a significant portion of us recognize, an even smaller fraction that just a tiny bit of us recognize, and then most of us have our own collection of hats in the closet. So Dr. Hahn feels that we can use this, that I can take this knowledge from a population, I can study it closely, and then I can begin to make assumptions, I can begin to draw inferences about what it means for each one of us. So if I take my blood and I look at my collection of hats, the hats that I share in common, how many hats do I share in common with that 90% group? He feels that that's a measure of your health. Do you have the high amount of shared in common? These are the things that probably we are all continually looking for. If I have very few of those highly common ones, I don't have very good health. Then the next two categories, the ones that are shared by a small number of individuals, it's beginning to look like these are markers of disease, that specific diseases your immune system is actively, your immune system is battling and is looking for a common set of hats. So I can look among the green and the red group and see if there are some specific hats that are indicative that your immune system is dealing with a certain disease, even before you may develop many symptoms of it. And then the blue pieces are potentially, these are the ones that are uniquely yours. I may be able to use these for therapy because I may discover that you have a specific hat in your closet that is going to recognize a specific disease, a specific tumor, for example, and I can use that and those T cell therapies I talked to you about just a few slides ago. I can take that, I can make lots of copies of that and use that as your defense system. I am painting this with a really broad brushstroke, and I apologize to Dr. Hahn that I am not doing justice to his work. But let me take you another step further. Dr. Hahn is an amazing left brain, right brain individual. He's found a beautiful way to visually illustrate how diverse your immune system is, how many hats are in your immune system closet. And he does it with this thing called an imprint. And the imprint, each color, each dot is a different part of what your immune system is actively recognizing. And the bigger the dot, the more energy your immune system is pouring into it. This is a diverse, healthy immune system. It looks different than an immune system of an individual that is dealing with breast cancer, which has fewer dots and the dots are bigger, and an individual that has heart disease, which has even less diversity, even fewer hats in your closet, and some consistent hats that show up across multiple people with the same disease. So this is a beautiful way, a quick visual of the health of your immune system. Dr. Hahn has taken this and has started an initiative called R10K, Repertoire 10,000. And the goal of this is to look at 100 different diseases and 100 people with each disease and look to see if there are disease-specific immune signatures. Are the immune systems focused in on the same sort of thing for all people that have type 1 diabetes, or all people that have congestive heart failure, or all people that have breast cancer? So he's trying to understand, are there common immune signatures? And he's partnered with Hudson Alpha and with Illumina, which is the lead sequencing, DNA sequencing group, and with one of his companies, iRepertoire. And he has recruited collaborators from around the world who have samples of individuals with a disease that they're willing to look at the immune system and look for patterns. Okay, this last image, in a nutshell, is the identified signatures of the immune system focused on the disease. So this is early preliminary data. I'm only going to show it to you for two different diseases. But essentially, we're looking for specific hat combinations. We're looking for specific T cell receptors that appear commonly among individuals with the disease and are not present or are present much, much less frequently in individuals without the disease. So let me say that again. We're taking a blood sample and we're looking at the immune cells and we're looking specifically at the hats. And we're looking for hats, we're looking for T cell receptors that are recognizing hats that are common among people with disease and are either not present or are much, much less common among people without disease. Because the thought is, if you find a disease-specific signature, that then becomes your biomarker. Just like in week one when we talked about liquid biopsies and biomarkers. So the image behind me is of liver cancer. And if you start with the box all the way on the left, these are patients with liver cancer. And the other three boxes are patients that have other types of liver diseases, not liver cancer, or are controls, they don't have any liver cancer. The dots are a specific frequency, a specific measure of this signature that Dr. Hahn has found associated with liver cancer. The higher they go on the y-axis, the more frequent that signature is seen. So on the left is the liver cancer, and it is seen at least one and sometimes two orders of magnitude, 10 to 100 times more frequently or higher levels in individuals with liver cancer than in these other groups. And there's a clear dividing line. So the box and whisker plot shows you the scatter and the spread. So you've got relatively high amounts of this specific immune signature in people with liver cancer that you don't have. This is a logarithmic scale that you don't have in people that don't have liver cancer. So this potentially is an immune biomarker for liver cancer. This one is looking at renal cancer, at clear cell carcinoma, a certain type of renal cancer. Again, here's the cancer. And here are other forms of kidney disease or other forms of or normal patients. This is, again, a logarithmic scale. The frequency that you see the specific signature for renal cancer, which is a totally different immune signature than for kidney cancer. And it's seen at a much higher frequency than in these other non-kidney cancer patients. This is really early data, and I'm not explaining it to the level that it deserves to be explained at. But the point that I want you to, I think the point you can see is that there is something here. This is clearly different. And because this is a logarithmic scale, this is occurring at a much higher frequency than it is among these people that don't have that disease. And it is unique to the people that have the disease. If this holds up, then you can have a blood sample, you can measure what your immune system is actively fighting before you even know that you have symptoms. Your immune system is attacking, remember I told you, your immune system is attacking cancers and destroying them all the time and you're not even aware of it. This is potentially one of those liquid biopsy biomarkers, but instead of looking for a protein associated with the cancer, you're reading your immune system and saying, what's your immune system fighting? What do you need to be paying attention to, because your immune system is certainly paying attention to it. Really interesting kind of work digging around the immune system. Okay, so we're coming to the end. Next Tuesday, we're gonna do our final two hallmarks of cancer: genomic instability, which in a nutshell is we let lots more mutations happen, and the whole process of metastasis and invasion and cancer stem cells and recurrence. And then we're gonna put it all together and we're gonna talk about the war on cancer and some analogies and images of the war on cancer. As in previous weeks, I've got genetic counselors. Hudson Alpha genetic counselors are here. They have volunteered of their time. If you've got questions you'd like to ask them, there'll be one up here and there'll be two in the back. So feel free. Remember, one more time, they are not giving you medical advice that you take to the bank. They are giving you educational advice on what next steps might be with genetic professionals. So have a great week, everybody. I will see you on Tuesday night, and thank you for being with me on tonight. Thank you.